Good morning, everyone. This is Brother Lloyd, and to those who are keeping the Sabbath today, peace and many blessings. Now, people are constantly running around claiming that they love the Father so much, yet no one else sees it in them. So the question is, why not? Is it a secret that some of these individuals are keeping to themselves, or is it just that the majority of people aren't expressing the true love they claim to have for the Father in the way they walk and talk and live their lives? This is the key. Others have to see this steadfast consistency in the way we walk, talk, and live our lives to know and acknowledge that we love the Father without us having to always proclaim out loud how much we love the Father. When we do these things with consistency, people will acknowledge it to you and to others, and they will say things like, "Man, he or she sure loves the Father." So now let's check out some of the principles that we started last week on expressing our love for the Father. Okay, now let's continue on with our principles. Today we're going to discuss principles number 3 and 4. And remember, like I said, I'm only going to discuss what I consider 6 basic principles that I like to talk about. And there can be more or less depending on how you want to view it. But I'm going to use these 6 as a foundation because I think they kind of encompass the majority of everything that we can think about. Now, there are many ways to view this, but we need to set something as a barometer to measure what we do and use it as a guide. So that's why I'm doing this. So now let's get to principle number 3, which is putting the Heavenly Father above all else. Remember, no one can serve 2 masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else hold on to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon, or you can't serve the Father in things like money and possessions. That's Luke 16:13. Now look, there's nothing evil about owning the things we need. The problem can start when we start this desire or want to collect wealth and possessions beyond our need. And this may cause some of us, or many of us, to start to neglect our duty to the Father, to our families, and to mankind. This is the problem when people start acquiring more than what they need. So, simply put, people can get caught up, and often they do, in this stuff, in money, in things, in accomplishments. People get caught up and start neglecting the thing that got them there. And usually that's the Father and His blessings. People get caught up and it starts becoming about self. Now, acquiring more starts to become the goal and their objective. And then, like I said, they start neglecting all these other things. This is where the problem starts. The selfishness starts to creep in and take over. See, our Savior said that serving the Father and serving wealth are incompatible goals. Or the want or desire for positions today is even stronger because the temptation is greater, the access to them is greater, and people work long and stressful hours to acquire these things. And that starts a neglect even before they acquire some of these things. And people do all this sacrificing so they can acquire what? That luxury car, bigger houses, designer clothing, and countless other items so they can travel all the time and eat at all the fancy restaurants and do all these expensive things. The neglect starts to just take over their life. And they start to what? Forget about the Father who got them there. So now you can see the picture, and I'm sure you all know people who have fallen into this, if it's not you yourself. See, when the rich man asked the Savior what must he do to inherit eternal life, in Matthew 19:16-24, or Mark 10:17-25, He already knew the man's heart. See, the Savior knows all. The Father knows everything. So when the man asked him the question, what did he tell him? He told him to sell all his possessions and give the money to the poor. But sadly, as it would be many times over today, the man could not bring himself to do it because he was caught up with his stuff. He refused to sell all his stuff and give the money to the poor to follow the Savior. Man, that's a trade-off. What a trade-off. You are so attached to the world. That's all it's illustrating. The attachment to the world is so great for some that they will not let it go for the promise. See, they can't see the promise, so people aren't willing to let it go. Now, if people could see it, if there was a picture of it right there in front of them, the Father opened the door up and showed it to them, and many people would falsely accept it because they can see something that's tangible, they can touch it. But that's not the case. We have to have a faith and believe. Now, in Mark 7:20-23, he added this. He said, "That which cometh out of man, that defileth the man. For from within, out of the heart of men, proceed evil thoughts, adulteries, fornications, murders, thefts, covetousness, wickedness, deceit, lasciviousness, an evil eye, blasphemy, pride, foolishness. All these evil things come from within and defile the man." See, what's in us can defile us just as much of things that we bring into our lives, these things out in the world. Corrupt thinking and thoughts defile us from within, and the things in the world defile us from the outside by bringing it in. So to keep the commandment to love the Father with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength, we must always keep the things of the Father what? In the forefront of our minds. We can never forget that, no matter what we're acquiring or what we're receiving from the world. It keeps our thinking clear when we always focus on Him and let the Holy Spirit and the will of the Father steer us and guide us in what we do. Now, with that being said, principle number 4 follows right on and says what? We must be committed. You must be committed. Principle number 4, commitment. Matthew 16:24-26 reads like this. Then Jesus said unto his disciples, "If any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, and whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. For what is a man profited if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? And what shall a man give in exchange for his soul?" It sums it up in a nutshell. If you're willing to sacrifice all for the gains of the world, that's your choice. But if you're willing to sacrifice in His name's sake or for His name's sake, you will find life after that, eternal life. See, the Savior was straight and to the point about anyone who would be a follower. He had to be willing to sacrifice as He did, and you have to be committed. The requirement has not changed from that day to this day. He was totally and passionately committed to fulfilling His earthly mission. And we have to be committed the same way to fulfill our earthly mission. We have an earthly mission just like He did. So many people will say that they can never live up to those standards and do the things that He did. But imagine how great your life would be if you had that determined focus to do the Father's will. We must do our best every day by the way we live our life through faith, every hour, every second of every day. To be what? To be perfect in Him. See, the Word doesn't say we have to be perfect in the world. We have to be perfect through Him. Look, not only must we be committed, but we must be committed for the right cause. We must be sure through what? Through study and prayer that we're following the Father's agenda, the heavenly agenda, and not our own. We must be sure to follow His commandments, Exodus 20:1-17, and the teachings of the Savior in Matthew 5:6-7, His teachings on the Mount. So if we study those two and really delve into them to understand them, they will be the great guide and barometer for following the will of the Father. See, we can find commitment to be inconvenient and difficult sometimes, especially when we're committing to what the Father requests and requires us to do. See, because we can what? We can suffer loss, we can suffer power, prestige, and even suffer loss of life. Remember what happened to Job. He lost possessions and he lost family, but yet he held on to his faith and his belief. And we must be willing to do that even unto the possibility of death. We must do these things. He promises that his burden will never be too great to bear, though. Go with me to 1 Corinthians 10, 13, and Matthew 11, 28 through 30. Now I'm going to read all four of these together because they make total sense and it illustrates how the Father's word flows and makes sense. This is why we have to study scripture and know it all so it all can come together and make sense for us. And like I said, once again, 1 Corinthians 10, 13, I'm going to start there and then I'm going to read right into Matthew 11, 28 through 30. There have no temptation taken you, but as such is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that ye may be able to bear it. Come unto me, all that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. He's saying that anything that we're tempted by, we're only going to be tempted to a point to which we can bear it. There's also going to be a way to avoid the temptation so that we can survive it. He's not going to leave us out there hanging. So as a believer, if we feel the weight and pressure of these things or these burdens, turn to him for the relief and he will give us peace and rest. We have to learn from him through his trials. We have to learn how to be meek and humble, and rest shall come to us. But we have to do it through him. This is what he simply tells us. Look, commitment to carrying out the Father's plan may be inconvenient and conflict with our own selfish desires, because that's what they are, selfish desires. There may be conflict in that, but we have to dispel that. We have to overcome that and understand that he offers us eternal and a much greater reward on the other side in comparison to what we selfishly desire. We have to understand that if we want to make it. So we have to choose what is best for us as individuals, because like I always say, we have free will. But we have to understand what being humble and meek is all about. And that's going to be in Principles 5 and 6. And with that being said, this is Brother Lloyd. I'm out till next time.